Hello, hi. I'm Dr. P. Shivaranjani, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Application. Today we'll discuss about menus and dialogue and how to build a non-blocking guide concept in your Java programming. So before getting into it, we have to know a class called as J menu bar. Inside J menu bar, you have a object that is called as JMenu and JMenu item. So these two object will help you to access your class called as JMenu bar. So JMenu bar class is used to display a menu bar on the window or the frame. So it has many menus. So by the help of JMenu class, you can pull down the menu component which is to be displayed from the menu bar. It has been inherited from the class called as JMenuItem. The next object is object of JMenuItem class. So this will add simply a label menu items. So the item used in menu must belong to a JMenuItem or of its any subclasses. So how to declare the class declaration of JMenuBar? Here you have to use a keyword called as a public. So it means that the class is accessible to all, and the name of the class is JMenuBar, and just you are extending J component and implementing your menu elements. That menu element should be accessible. So this is the way you have to declare your J, that is your menu bar. And similarly, you can define menus also by using a class. So the second syntax will specify how to declare a J menu. You have to use a keyword called as public class J menu, extend J menu item, implement menu element. That menu element should be accessible to the user. So similarly, third statement explains how to display a menu item. So here you are creating a class called as JMenuItem. So that menu item is extend the abstract button and implements the accessible and menu events. So this is the way of declaring your JMenuBars. So here the example will explain what is menu and what is menu bar and what is called as menu item. So here in the window, in the example, in the window, you can see that you have a small window with an option with a name called as menu and menu item example. So that is the name of the particular window. And I have created a menu bar called as a menu. Inside a menu, I have a option called as, I have three options, that is item 1, item 2 and item 3, and I have a submenu also. That submenu contains item 4 and item 5. So here menu is nothing but the menu, and menu bar is nothing but the item 1, item 2, item 3 is called as a menu bar, and a menu item is nothing but item 4 and item 5 is the menu items. So this example will explain how this particular diagram or the window has to be displayed. So here I imported a class called as a swing class inside my Java program, and I have created a class called as a menu. So menu example. So then I am creating some objects for the particular class, that is your JMenu, menu, submenus. So JMenu is nothing but your menu item, is nothing but your I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. So these are all the menu items. Then you're creating a constructor named as menu name. Menu example. So inside the particular constructor, you're creating a window. The name for the particular window is menu and menu item example. Next, I'm creating an object for the particular menu bar. So JMenuBar and the object is MB to access the particular menu bar. Then I am creating a menu called as an object called as a menu in order to accessing the particular menu. And similarly, I'm creating another object for accessing your submenus also. Then I'm using an menu to access your menu item. I have created a file object, that is I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. So this will be the menu items. The next one is adding the particular. So now I'm just adding the inside your window, I'm just adding the particular control, that is your item. So menu dot add I1, similarly I2, I3, I4, I5. So this 5 items are added inside a class called as a menu. So then inside the particular menu, there is also a, you can able to notice that menu 1, 2, 3 are main menu, and whereas I4 and I5 are submenus, that is sub menu items. Okay, so menu dot add submenus. So this will help you to add your submenu inside your menu. So similarly, I'm just adding my menu inside my created window, that is your panel, that is MB, that is your menu bar. Then inside my frame, that is your window, created window, you're just adding that particular menu bar, and I'm setting the size of the particular menu as 400,400, and I'm the menu should be visible. The layout is not visible, but it but the frame should be visible for the user. Now I'm just creating an object in the main program. I'm just creating an object for the class called as menu example. So this particular constructor will be automatically loaded, and it will display the output of what we have seen earlier. So the next one is Java dialog. So Java dialog is just similar to your menu bar. But the main different is the Java, your J dialog will not have the screen called, will not have an option that is your minimize, maximize and close and all. So you'll have only that is only the cancel button will be available. So it will be just in the format of dialog box, right? So okay, only one button will be available, right? That's it. So that is the Java dialog. So the Java dialog control represents the top level window with the border and the title used to take some of the form of the input from the user. It inherits the dialog class. So unlike JFrames, it does not have maximize and minimize button. So in panel window or created window, you'll have a maximize, minimize buttons, whereas in dialog classes or dialog box, you will not have this maximize and minimize button, but it will have close button. So this next one is your JDialog class declaration. So here the JDialog class will be declared by using a keyword called as a public, followed by class name, and the name of the class as JDialog. And just I'm extending a super class called as dialog, and I'm implementing window constant, and it should be accessible, and the root pan containers, all the things should be used inside my dialog controls. So these are some of the commonly used constructors. The first one is J dialog. So it is used to create a modeless dialog without title and without specified the frame owners. So by the help of this J dialog constructor, you can create a dialog without title, without specified frame owners. The next one is JDialog with an argument frame owner. So this is modeless dialog with the specified frame as owner, and you'll have it, but you'll specify the owner of the particular dialog, but you'll not have but it will not have any title of the particular dialog box. The next one is JDialog frame owner, comma string title, comma boolean model. So this constructor is used to create a dialog with a specified title, with the specified owner name, owner frame and modality, right? So these three constructors are commonly used by the J dialog properties. So now you're creating a window. We'll say an example of how to create a J dialog in your Java program. So the below the next the following code will explain how to create your J dialog control in your Java program. So for implementing your J dialog, I'm used a swing component, AWT component, and your event component inside your Java program, and I have created a class called as dialog example. So this dialog example will contain the function called as a constructor called as a dialog example. So you're creating a frame. The name of the frame is the object for accessing the particular frame is F, and I'm just naming the particular frame as F comma dialog comma true. So here you're passing the three parameters. So here the name will be dialog example, and the frame and the owner of the frame will be available to the external users. So I'm setting the layout of the particular frame. Then I'm adding a button inside the dialog. For that I have used J button, and object to access the particular button is B, and I have named the particular button as OK. So now, by using an action listener, you can record what kind of action has been performed in the particular dialog box. So for that, I'm using b.addActionListener function. So inside that, I'm using a function called as actionPerform function. Now I'm opening the particular dialog example window. And that should be visible. That should not be visible. It should display only the action that has been performed. Then the next thing is I'm just adding the particular button inside your dialog, and I'm just adding the button called as B. That is your created button. That is click button to continue. So that has been added over there, and that size has been set as 300,300. I'm setting the and the particular dialog should be visible to the user. So in main program, I'm just creating an object for the particular class called as dialog example. So once the object has been created, the constructor will be automatically executed, and the corresponding code will be executed, and it will be displaying the output of the window with the dialog box controls. So the next one is how to build non-building non-blocking guys. So the web container in web application servers normally uses server thread per client request. So for each client, a client request, the web container will use a particular server thread for each and every client, so that it can able to identify which particular client is making a request and which particular client has make a particular request will be recorded by the help of this non-blocking guides. So to develop a scalable web application, you must ensure that the thread associated with the client request or it should not sit idle waiting for a particular event to occur or to block it, for blocking the operation to complete. So before getting into it, you should know the two different types of processing, that is your synchronized processing and asynchronous processing. Synchronized processing basically means that you can only execute one thing at a time, but whereas in case of asynchronous means you can execute multiple things at a time, so you won't have to finish executing the current thing in order to move on to next one. So you can do a multiple task by the help of asynchronous processing, whereas in the case of synchronous processing, only one execution can take place at a time. So this diagram explains the diagrammatic representation of your asynchronous and synchronous process. So here there are two processes called as process A and process B in both the cases, that is in synchronous and asynchronous case. So in synchronous case, when a process A is making a request, then the request is being accepted by the server, and the server will go and search for the particular request. And when the another process gets enter into it and it make a request, it will not provide the server will not provide any response for the particular request of process B, because it is a synchronous process. Where in the case of asynchronous process, when the process A and B is making a request at the same time, the server will provide a response within a fraction of time. So this is the concept of building your blocking guide in your Java programming environment. So building your non-blocking guide in your Java environment, so you can pass many clients can pass many number of requests to the server. So this non-blocking guide will help you to provide a response. Whatever the request has been provided by the client will be accepted by the server, and the server will provide the corresponding response as a output for the corresponding user. So whereas in the case of non-blocking server in Java, so here you will have a function called as a read function. So here the read message reader will read the particular function and send to the channel, and channel will read. So here each and every request will be stored in the format of separate channel, so that it can able to identify which particular user is making a which particular request. So that's it, so that it can give the response accordingly. So asynchronous process provides a mechanism to execute the application specific block operation in a new threads, returning a thread associated with the requested immediately to the containers. So here you have to follow four different type of step in order to use your non-blocking input output to process your request and write response inside your service method. The first one is you have to put the request asynchronous mode as described in synchronous process. So you have to put all the requests in the mode of asynchronous mode, and you obtain an input stream and an output stream from the request and response the object in the service method. Then the third step is you have to assign a read listener to input stream and a write listener to the output stream. And the fourth step is you have to process the request and response inside the listener, listener's callback method. So this is the fourth step you have to follow in building your non-blocking guides. So how does this non-blocking input output support in your Java program? So in order to support your non-blocking input output in your Java program, so there are three different types of method is being used. The first one is set read listener method. So this set read listener method will listen to the particular object that contains the callback method to read the data synchronously, asynchronously, and you can also provide the listener object as an asynchronous class, or you can use other mechanism to pass the input parameters to read your listener object. And the next function is boolean is ready. It returns true if the data can be read without blocking, and similarly if it is complete, if it has complete in returning the particular reading the particular data, then you can make use of a function called as is finish function. So this function will return true when all the data has been readed. So the next one is listener interfaces for non-blocking input-output support. So here we'll make use of read listeners and write listeners. So the read listeners contains three different types of methods. The first one is on data available. The second one is on all data read. And third one is on error. So these three methods are used for read listener. So here the servlet input stream will call these method on this listener when there is a data available to read. When all the data has been read, or when the data is in error. So in such case, you can make use of this three methods for reading the particular data, and the data has been available or the data has readed with the help of error, then the following methods can be used accordingly. So similarly, for writing listener, you can use two different types of method, that is on write and on throw on error. So here this method will the servlet output string classes instant call this method on the listener, on its listener method, when it is possible to write data without blocking or when there is an error in your program. So thank you. That's it. So thank you for your patient listening.